And I'm starting the webinar.
Very good morning, warm welcome, students and teachers of school. Today we have Professor S.K. Ray, IIT Kharagpur, former director S.N. Bose Center, National Center for Basic Sciences, Kolkata, for third lecture of the science series. We also have Dr. Vandana Nandan, Professor, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, General Secretary, Indian Physics Association with us. I am Dr. Devesh Avasthi, Dean R&D at University of Petroleum Energy Studies, Dehradun. I would like to give a short background as I have been giving. There may be some new students in this. So UPES initiated a science series consisting of 6 lectures by renowned scientists of India and abroad, especially for school students and teachers. This is in association with Institute of Physics UK, Indian Physics Association IPA, and Indian Association of Physics Teachers, IAPT. There have been more than 1,000 students registered attending the lecture, which shows that the school students and teachers are liking the lecture. First lecture was on plasma by Dr. Shashank, Director IPR Ahmedabad. Second lecture was on nanoelectronics by Director IIT Delhi, which revealed the strong connection between physics and engineering and nanoelectronics. Today is the third lecture of the series by Professor Samit K. Ray, and he's renowned for his work in the field of material science, and he'll be speaking on wonderful world of material science. Thankful to Professor Ray for his sparing his valuable time for lecture to the students. For your information, all those students who attend 4 out of 6 lectures will be given e-certificate for participation in this event. Further, there will be quiz at the end of lecture series on 7th August, based on the questions from the lectures and school level science knowledge. 2 quizzes are planned separately for school students and teachers. The students and teachers attending the lectures, the prizes for both the quiz are sponsored by Indian Physics Association and Institute of Physics UK. With this word, I would like to request Professor Vandana Nandan, General Secretary IPA, to give her remarks. Over to Professor Vandana.
Thank you, Professor Avasthi, and very good morning and a warm welcome to all of you. On behalf of IPA, I would like to say that the IPA, the Indian Physics Association, is extremely happy to be part of this wonderful lecture series. We all know that in the last 1.5 years, the life has been very, very difficult because of the pandemic. And this series is a classic example of turning the challenges into opportunities. It's because of this online series using this current mode and the current new vistas which have opened, we all are able to now discuss science or discuss things which interest us and even from the world. This series aimed at the students and teachers is really wonderful because we all have this question that why we want to do science. And it's one of the objectives of the Indian Physics Association, which was formed in 1970. We just celebrated our 5 decades, is the outreach. We want to sort of facilitate interactions among the people who are interested in doing physics or science in general, and through the various bulletins and through the lecture series. Please visit our webpage for more information. I do not want to take too much of your time, but I would just like to say one line that today everybody uses the smartphone, and that's the kind of device that, you know, so that our life is so much dependent on science, from things like smartphone to everything up to the medical emergencies. COVID is fresh in everybody's mind, liquid oxygen transport everybody is talking about, and in all of these things, somewhere or other, the knowledge which we learn through basic science has gone in. So I again congratulate UPES for this series, other partner institutions also, IOP and IIPT, and we look forward to a wonderful lecture by Professor Ray. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Vandana. Let me briefly introduce Professor Samit K. Ray before the lecture. He is former director, S.N. Bose National Center for Basic Science, Calcutta, and is currently working as a professor, Department of Physics, IIT Kharagpur. After graduation and PhD from IIT Kharagpur, he joined Defense Lab as scientist in 1984. IIT Kharagpur as lecturer and rose to the position of full professor and Professor HAG in 2010. He has been founder and head of the School of Nanoscience and Technology and has been Dean R&D. He has completed 16 sponsored projects and supervised 26 PhDs. His research interests are in the area of semiconductor nanostructures, quantum dots, photovoltaics, energy harvesting of devices. Professor Ray is a science, Indian National Academy of Engineering. He has published more than 350 research papers in the peer-reviewed journals and co-authored a book on strained silicon heterostructures, materials and devices, published by IEEE UK. Professor Ray is a recipient of several national and international awards. A few of them are INSA Young Scientist Award, Homi J. Bhabha Award, MRSI Medal Lecture Award, CDIL Award of IET. He is fellow of National Academy of Sciences, Indian National Academy of Engineering and West Bengal Academy of Sciences and Technology. Professor Ray has published more than 300 research papers in peer-reviewed international journals. He has been visiting several universities as a visiting professor, like Tokyo Institute of Technology, Japan, University of Delaware, New York, USA, University of Texas, USA, Max Planck Institute, Germany, Queen's University of Belfast, UK, National Taiwan University, Taiwan. He is editorial board member of several international journals of repute. He serves in a number of committees of Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. With this brief introduction, I request Professor Ray for the lecture. Over to Professor Ray.
I think Professor Ray is muted.
I've just unmuted. Is it okay now?
Yeah, we can hear you.
We can hear you, okay. And my screen is screen visible, so I have to make full screen.
Right, please, yeah.
Is it full screen now?
Yeah, perfect. Perfect. Yeah.
Good. So thank you so much and good morning to everybody. And very special thanks to Professor Avasthi, who is my long-time friend, to invite me for this exciting lecture because now we are interacting with the students, which is very, very challenging and very exciting. And of course, some of the organization which has sponsored or which are organizing the lecture, I want to thank all UPSC Radun. IOP, I am involved by the editorial board. IPA and IAPT, we are also involved a lot with these organizations for the science outreach and science popularization. So today we have chosen a topic like the wonderful world of digital science. This is very, very important, particularly that we have seen that how the challenges become lots of opportunity for the mankind. And even for the last 1.5 years, a lot of innovation has been taken place on materials to fight the COVID pandemic. So of course, I will not go to that. Rather, I will go to a historical perspective. And we try to see why the materials plays such an important role in the progress of civilization and as well as the science and engineering. So material science may look a kind of a new word to the students, but this is nothing new. This is basically the physics and chemistry of materials, to be very specific. Of course, there is a biology, there is a mathematical modeling. So this is in science, and normally research is done, or probably the master's level, a lot of courses are given the material science. So this is nothing new. This is a part of the physics and chemistry. What is most important, why the material is so important, if you see that even the historical perspectives, many of the ages are actually in the civilizations are named after the development of materials. For example, the first thing that we said about 2 billion years ago that we used to call it a stone age. With this head, so the people used to use only naturally available materials for stone, wood, clay, skins for their wearable clothes, for their daily livelihood. So then there is a progress Then came the Stone Age. We used to call them the Stone Age. From after the Stone Age, we have come to the age called the Bronze. When the people tried to innovate a little bit with the materials, the only materials that time are available probably some kind of a metals. So they actually started mixing two different metals, like copper is a metal which was available, but copper is too soft for using for any practical applications. So they actually, without knowing anything, they mix some amount of tin or other elements to a new material, which is called an alloy, which is called the broach, to use as the utensils and daily uses. Actually, this progressed a lot when the Iron Age came about 3,000 years back, and which still continues till today, particularly the invention of the steel. As you know, the steel is a very, very stronger and a cheaper material. Is the drastically the daily life of a common person. We have got now railways, we have got engineering, we have got railways, tracks, building, etc. All are made of steel. So you can see the advances in material started from actually the invention of steel. And today, in this century or the last century, we are in the age of the advance. A lot of materials, I'll be naming some of them. You may have heard, but you don't need to be hearing everything, probably you'll be hearing when you come to a college, some kind of material called ceramics that you use every day in your home as the cup, as the dishes, etc., for utensils, semiconductor materials, which are used for all your computers, iPhone, which will come to my lecture, will actually concentrate more on semiconductors today. So since this is a very, very vast history, it's very difficult to cover everything. So semiconductor is basically electronic material which is used for making electronic devices. Of course, you also know what is polymers. Today you have used lots of plastics, lots of top textiles. Those plastic bags are actually nothing but some kind of polymers. So this is a class of materials which the chemists have invented. Then the people actually, if you see, before this, these are all more or less all about naturally available. But in the modern age materials, the people now know how to make different kind of materials with different properties, in the laboratory. So they wanted to mix materials with composites, compound. And very recently, these are some of the exciting research topics nowadays, like in nanomaterials, quantum materials, and the list is unending. I cannot name everything. So what is the most important? You can make some innovation in the progress of material science when you understand the relationship between their physical structure, what are the properties, and what are the performance. So a lot of physics, chemistry, as I said, mathematics are involved in designing new materials, and everyday new materials. Okay, so this is actually what I have to say. Let me, I have taken some examples, of course, that some of the breakthrough materials that has actually made civilization progress to the modern age. And almost all of you use this every day. I don't have to say, talk about your personal computer, mobile phone, etc. These are all actually, so the computer is supposed to be one invention actually which has drastically changed the, I mean, the quality of the human life. So not only computation, but also through internet, through your WhatsApp, through Facebook, everything, you are in touch with your friends, then you get lots of information in a fraction of a second. So this is one invention which has changed the history probably in the last 50 years or so. Then of course the diode lasers. So I am sure that you have heard, at least you have seen some of the lasers that of course gas lasers were available for a long time, but making the simply tiny diode, like a PN junction diode that you get in the market, you can get the laser out of optical device and you see it everywhere, starting from laser pointer to your CD, DVD disc. If you visit your grocery every day in our shopping mall, they scan your barcode, then surgery of the eye, cutting of metals. So unending applications can be done by the diode lasers. And very, very recently, if you see all the lights in the city, all the white lights, actually these are called the LED lights. So these are not the lasers, but the same material which gives the LEDs. So this is electronic materials, photonic materials. Okay, then I have taken, these are my favorite topics, so that's why I have chosen some materials only. Then there is some materials which are called superconductors. We know what is called conductivity, that if you pass some amount of, apply some amount of voltage in a metal, actually it carries some current, okay. So that means there is something called the, in a metal, we define something called the resistance, which is defined for the Ohm's law. Ohm's law is V equal to I into R. From there, we actually define the resistance. The current will flow through your metal will depend upon resistance. So there are some materials, actually they are called superconductors, which has got zero resistance. So that means ideally you can pass infinite amount of current through a metallic wire. So this is a kind of a dream kind of technology, that if you put lots of current through a metallic wire, and if you make a coil out of them, you can make electromagnet with a very, very high magnetic strength. But this is used in today's technology, all the bullet trains, actually India is also planning trains. So this works in a principle called magnetic levitations. So if you have a very, very high power magnet, so there will be no friction between the railway track and the wheels of the train. So actually that's why actually the trains can run at a speed of 400, 500 kilometers per hour. That's there in Japan, China, and many advanced countries. So these are all demonstrated, but you know that scientists are not happy with whatever they have. They want to invent something, and that's why the science and technology progresses. So this is one example. Probably we are thinking about the next generation. Can we mimic the human brain? Can you make the artificial brain? Students, I'm sure that you have heard a lot of things about the artificial intelligence in a media. Actually, the media, these things that you can create artificial intelligence. Of course, that is based on the algorithm, or that's based on the software, but you must be having some hardware elements to make the really artificial. Can you make a vehicle which does not need a driver? Can you some kind of mimic the brain? So this is actually very, very challenging. And you know, in the brain, we have got actually that billions of actually neurons, and they are interconnected. So what they're trying to make in the lab now, you are making a lot of materials which actually behaves like neurons, and the neuron cells are connected together, because the brain is really supercomputer. because if you can think of some supercomputer, today's supercomputer, it takes megawatts of power and the size is very, very big. And compared to the way the brain works. So that, of course, so that means you have to make something. And in all these things, the example that I have taken, what is there in the heart is a materials. Like for a computer, there's something called the semiconductor called silicon inside the heart of this computer, which is nothing but a transistor, actually. You have heard the name of a transistor, that's the heart of a that CPU or in a computer. The lasers are actually based on some materials, again, semiconductor materials called gallium arsenide, indium phosphide. Go into details onto that. These are actually some superconducting materials, mostly metals, oxides. So they behave as a superconductor. And these are actually, you can make circuits in the lab to behave as a brain. These can be with a different thing. This can be molecules. This can be molecular transistors. This can be transistors made of tiny semiconductor nanoparticles. So that's why it is so interesting. So what is the future, actually? What is the, how is the progress? How does the progress and what we are looking for? Of course, we are looking for one thing is make it Apple, because you want to make your device, you want your iPhone or your the mobile phone to be as small as possible so that it can take very, very less amount of power. And you create something like a new kind of material called nanostructured materials. I'll come to that. I understand Professor Ram Gopal Rao has also taken a course on nanoelectronics. So some of you already know, but maybe for others, I will definitely introduce what is nanomaterial. So what today we are trying to do that we want to do a lot more to science and engineering so that we can make new materials which are not available in the nature. So we want to make a man-made materials. We want to make the materials very, very smart. So the material itself can take a decision without any computer. So these are called actually smart materials. So a lot of applications in the next generation IoT based technologies actually will be using the smart materials and sensors. A very crude example is that, see, you know the airplane wings actually when it goes, when it flies, the temperature outside is minus 40 degrees centigrade or so. But there should not be no freezing of the ice on the wings, then the plane will not fly. So they know how to unfreeze themselves. We make buildings which are earthquake prone. Even in the earthquake, nothing happens in the building. This is just a materials innovation. We can make textiles. We can make a lot of materials which actually self-cleans. I will come to that probably. Lotus leaves and self-cleaning, I'll come to that. We have to make a lot of environment-friendly materials. Of course, nowadays we make lots of nuclear waste. So the question, the challenge, this is still challenging, whether we can make it a biodegradable plastic bags, because we are using too much of plastic bags actually every day for our daily routine applications, and they're creating a lot of problem for the environment. Similarly, for the when you're using the nuclear, this thing for the power generation, there are a lot of nuclear or radioactive waste, whether it's possible to make them biodegradable. So these are the challenges. Then of course, that we always learn from the nature. That something whether we can synthesize in the laboratory. That is actually called the science. And that's what the researchers are doing. So I'll take some examples and show you today in today's lecture. And of course, since we are not happy, we have to make all kind of exotic materials, kind of all superstar materials with all super properties. We still feel our cell phone is too much weight. So we want to make the battery to be very, very small. Battery should have a much, much storage power. Better, maybe it's a cell phone, if it's flexible, I can put it as a card, as a credit card or debit card, and can we put in our bag? The question is yes, that's the way the people are working, and I'll show some of the technologies that are useful for making that. Can we make the superconductor? I was talking about the magnetic levitations, that normally superconductors use at a lower temperature, so it costs some energy. So can we make a room temperature superconductor? Can we make artificial nose? So this is based on something called chemical sensors. Artificial nose is very, very important. Can we actually detect by some sensors, whether there are some explosives, or even people are thinking, can we actually detect the COVID-19 virus, this kind of sensing, chemical sensing, just simply we put artificial nose and know that, okay, this person is carrying the COVID-19 virus or or some other bodies carrying the COVID-19 virus. So this is all possible, or almost nearly possible. This is no longer a dream. And there are enormous amount of applications. I cannot go on telling that. Everything started from textiles to daily use materials. We can do a lot of innovation. So along with the development of materials in the laboratory, then there came technology which we call actually thin films. That means thin film is nothing but a coating of some materials. So let me put this bar somewhere. So thin films is something that means thin film is nothing but coating. So let me start with a very crude application of thin films. So of course you know what is thin, and you know film means that means you are making some kind of coating on a material. So the crudest example may be the painting on a car. So if you paint on a car, of course it looks bright, it looks beautiful, but that is not the only use of this painting. This painting is actually corrosion resistance, oxidation resistance, so that the color of the car does not go bad, or even the body of the material does not deteriorate. So this coating is done everywhere. Even if you see we use a lot of the watches, which are titanium watches with golden color. So this is nothing but a coating of some material called titanium nitride on this watch material. Or the wally, and you see optical properties like gold. So we feel that we are actually having a golden watch. Of course, a lot of example is there. You use always the goggles with ultraviolet coating, and you know how costly is a goggles with UV coating. Nowadays you can get goggles with some kind of coating so that you can see in the night even. So this is called the night vision goggles. Of course, this is not used for a common man. This is only used for the armies who are actually patrolling our border. They have some kind of night vision goggles that somebody is trespassing the border or so. Then of course that CPU or the microprocessor or the computer chips contains lots of thin films of metals, insulators, semiconductors, and whatnot actually. And this, they have at least 20 to 30 different layers of thin films of these materials. Why this is necessary? Because thin film, the thickness, I'll come to thickness. Thickness is very, very small. If the thickness is very small, it will be light in weight. The cost of the material will be low, and you can get here. And of course, the simplest example of a coating of a thin film of metal like a silver on this thing is the mirror that you use at the home. If you put a aluminum or silver or any other metal, reflecting metal on a glass, you get a mirror. So these are the examples that we are using for a long time. So based on thin film coating of materials. So next slide. Okay. Now, as you say that, we always want something to be very, very light, you know, accessible. This should take low power. So in future, electronics and computer chips or many other actually applications, we are thinking of to be flexible. So the question that we're asking, can we have a mobile phone which we can really fold it and keep it on our money bag or the purse so that it does not carry? But for that, of course, you have to, your battery of the mobile phone has to be flexible. So people are working on that. So many of these applications are actually in the future will be based on flexible devices as a new area of materials electronics that is emerging very fast. I also want to emphasize one more materials actually, particularly for the energy applications. As you know that one of the main problem in today's civilizations, of course, we have started a lot of automobiles, a lot of industrializations, but that has got a really, really a bad effect on the human health and environment, as you know. See, every year, if you see about 100 years or back or so, we have started actually doing lot of industrializations out of the carbon dioxide that we are actually emitting to the atmosphere. This is million ton of carbon dioxide. So today we are somewhere here in 2020, 2021. We are every year actually, we are using 30, every month, I'm sorry, per month, 35,000 million tons of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And because we are using, generating all this energy or electrical energy from our fossil fuel, either oil or the, and that's why the one thing that is very, very important, that we try to go to some materials which actually does not use this fossil fuel. They use a renewable energy sources, like it can be nuclear, or it can be some kind of materials called solar cells. So I don't know whether you have heard of what is solar cells, or sometimes what photovoltaic devices. You must have seen in many of the appliances nowadays, they put a solar cells. So the idea is that when the sunlight falls on the device, actually they generate some kind of current and voltage, and they generate some power. And since this is the abundant source of the sunlight, so you can really generate a lot of electrical power. You can reduce your actual use of this so-called the fossils. So that is actually what is important for the protecting our environment against the new generation. So since I was talking about the flexible solar cells or thin film solar cells, so in the future, we are thinking of, not in the future, the people have started doing. You see that you have, this is a solar cells, which is actually based nothing but a semiconductor PN junction diode made and simply printed on a actually plastic substrate. That's why it's flexible. It's a polymer actually. And you coat in your roof, you coat in your building, and coat everywhere so that you don't actually ultimately put too much of weight on the roof and generate electricity. So this is a kind of a innovation that is actually required for the next generation energy solution. And that only comes from the material science, because you are using all kinds of materials, from starting from glass, stainless steel, aluminum, polymer, and ceramics for your technology. Okay, so I think that I have been able to give you some example why the material science is so important, why the innovation of the material is so important for our next generation. Now, the question is that where are we heading? So what is the end of it? So what is, I said that the main, our main goal is to make every day some new materials, smart materials, and make a smaller size material. So of course we call small is beautiful, but not only that small is beautiful, smaller it is, it's bountiful. And not only that, if we make it smaller and smaller, we can actually see we can mimic the nature. A lot of things that we can see in our biological activities, we can mimic the nature. So now I'll take some example. Okay, so let us take the first example. This is the first so-called the computer actually in Manchester University in June 20, 1948. So the size of, in 1948, that time there was no transistor, all made of hulls, and it's computer by the whole room space. And probably the speed of the computer is very, very slow. You cannot think of doing that. And memory will be maybe few kilobytes or so. And you know how we have actually progressed from there. Just by reducing the dimension of the sizes, we went from hub to transistor, transistor to some CMOS circuits, and we have changed everything. So this idea of actual scaling of materials came for a one theoretical physicist. Probably, again, you have heard of this story. So this somebody called the Richard Feynman, who was a classical physicist, he was giving a lecture in 1959 to the American Physical Society. And he used to dream a lot. He was to have some wild ideas, he used to throw it out and try to see why this is not possible, why that is not possible. In his lecture, actually, he said, one of the sentences, if I take it, why cannot we write the entire 24 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica on the head of a pin? Think of, in 1960, we have just transistor invented. There was no integrated circuit computer, there was no microprocessor. So about 60 years back, he's thinking, why can't we write the whole Encyclopedia Britannica on the head of a pin? And that's what he said, that this is the technology that we want. This is his kind of dream. So let me talk about a little bit of scale of things before I say that what should be the dimension we are thinking of. So tera is, you know, 10 to the 12, giga 10 to the 9, because nowadays you know gigabit, megabit, all the memories, megapixels. Is a kilo, is a milli. So that means we are reducing the dimension, you go to the micro scale. Then we are going to that so-called the nanometer scale, which is 10 to the minus 9 meter. So when I call nanometer, the size of one nanometer is basically 10 to the minus 9 meter. And if you compare, if you just want to imagine how small it is. So let me tell you that one micrometer is about 1,000 times of a millimeter. So you can think the thickness of your hair is probably about, human hair is about 100 to 500 micrometers. So think of your, what is the size of the thickness of your hair, and come down to a few nanometers, you know that you can imagine how small is a nanometer. So the question is that, what happens if we make it nanometer, the material property changes, what do we do? So before doing that, let me go to the, again, continue with the Richard Feynman lecture of the APS meeting, that the title of the lecture was, there is a plenty of room in the bottom, and this was his dream. And today I can see this dream is possible very easily, because you know each edge is about the memory size of about 4 kilobytes. And if I assume that an encyclopedia has 1,000 pages, but of course it's much more than that, and you have a 24 volume, you only need about 100 megabit of a memory. But you know that the pen drive you to buy from the market, you buy in the gigabit, 4 gigabit, 8 gigabit, 16 gigabit. So actually it's a completely something that we can actually is achievable today. So what is the Feynman dream that has been actually achieved in the last decade or so? So he had also a lot of other ideas that can we manipulate individual atoms to make new materials or new structures. So Pratik said that you have to always make because every materials are nothing but actually assembly of atoms and molecules. So if you can really manipulate these atoms and molecules, you can change the property of the material. So in the laboratory, you can do that by one tool. It's called scanning tunneling microscope. I don't want to go into the detail. It's a very special kind of microscope, but it's not an optical microscope. This is a tunneling microscope, which can be used to manipulate atoms and make new materials. Of course, that was he's one of the ideas also building this scale of nanometers for more powerful computers that we are already doing. And he also at that time thought of that there must be a lot of existence of nanostructures in biological systems like your protein, DNA, etc. In fact, that has been studied today with the help of a lot of microscopes. So of course, at that time, it was a very, very wild idea. And the reaction of the audience probably was something like that. Surely you are joking, Mr. Feynman. I will ask my all young students to read this book of the Feynman. It's called The Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman. So you know his life history and what are these wild ideas he used to have. Very interesting. Now let us try to give in some more example and see that common materials that you use every day has got up a lot, depending upon the size of the materials, depending on the alignments of the atoms and molecules, they actually exhibit different properties. And what we try to do, we want to use that example and make our new material. For example, carbon. Carbon is one of the most important in our life. Without carbon, we cannot exist on this earth. And you know, I don't know, probably you have not seen, whether you have seen charcoal or also in the actual, which is used for firing a oven, used to be done in probably 20, 30, 40 years back in the household, particularly the village. So charcoal is made of a carbon material, of course, lots of carbon and other impurities. But they are very, very brittle because there are actually a lot of impurities and there is no actually ordering of the carbon molecules or carbon atoms in the charcoal. If you go to the next material called graphite, idea of use, when you use a pencil or this thing to draw or something, that is nothing but a graphite material. So graphite is some kind of materials. Actually, carbon has a lot of allotropy. So graphite is one of the allotropes. That is, you say all these carbon molecules or the carbon atoms are connected like this. So in the in-plane directions, in this XY plane, actually that is very, very hard. It's very difficult to break this atom or of the carbon, separate this. But out of plane, you can take out these carbon layers easily. So that is one property of the graphite. And that's why the graphite also has got a different property, different direction in the in-plane and out-plane. The thermal conductivity of graphite is very, very different. The conductivity of graphite is different. So this can be useful. I'll come to the example. Then, of course, you have heard of the diamond, okay? Very, very one of the costliest materials that is available in the earth's crust. Of course, natural diamond is available actually in the earth crust. And here the carbon molecules or the carbon atoms are actually arranged in a very, very particular structure, crystalline structure, which is called the diamond. And this is known as the hardest materials known so far. Of course, we know as a decorative ornament, etc., but diamond is not useful for that. Diamond has got a lot of other applications. So how hard is diamond? If I just give you an example, if you take a stainless steel knife and cut your butter, you know how smooth it is. If you take think of something like a diamond knife and put in a stainless steel, you can cut it in so easily. So that's actually the imagine that how hard the diamond it is. So this is a material which is a very high strength, which is a high thermal conductivity, very high conductivity. So that we can make some devices made of these materials, but this material has to be prepared in the lab as a diamond thin film. So that's what I saw. I told you that some things are available in the natural crust as the nature as these things, and we try to mimic them in the laboratory. And that's what is called material science. Okay, so what we did in the lab, we knew those are the forms that have shown as the carbon. These are available in the nature. But now the scientist started making some kind of different carbon elements or carbon laboratory. So last 30, 40 years, actually you see, one is called the fullerene. You don't have to remember the name, but these are nothing but actually carbon, 70 or 60 carbon atoms arranged in a particular structure called a Shocker ball structure or Bakke ball structure. So this is called C60, C70 structure. And this has got some exotic properties, like a very, very strong, very high conductivity, this is very strong material, and a lot of other superconductive properties. It was done by some chemist, and that's when the Nobel Prize was given in 1996 for this chemistry Nobel Prize. Then in 1990, of course, this nanotube was faster than this one. So these carbon molecules or carbon atoms also can be arranged in a cage. It's almost like one-dimensional cage. So this is called the carbon nanotube. You must have heard of that. So a lot of electronic circuits, sensor circuits can be made by using this carbon nanotube. They can be metallic, they can be semiconducting, they can be insulating. So you can really change the properties of the carbon nanotube and make a new defined kind of material. And just about one decade back, this Novoselov and Gaim showed that, as I find that you can take one layer out, if you can easily peel one of the layers by simply using a scotch tape, and you get a wonderful material called graphene. So this is a wonderful material. This material is now actually one of the highest mobility material, highest thermal conductivity material. So maybe one of the best semiconductors. It could be made semiconductor. It's not semiconductor, it's semi-metallic or metallic. So that's what actually shows that in this case, that what the scientists have done, they have prepared the carbon in different form in the laboratory. And they're actually called the nanostructures. This is called the zero-dimensional nanostructure made of carbon. This is called one-dimensional because it looks like a tube or looks like a rod. That's why it's one dimension. And this is called two-dimensional because this monolayer of graphene thickness is very, very small, about below 1 nanometer or so. So this is called a new generation of two-dimensional materials have been invented by using from the graphene. And now a lot of other materials are being invented with exotic and very, very interesting properties of the graphene. So that's the example. I have taken one more example, which is actually the example is available in the daily life. You have seen that. That's what I've taken this example. The calcium carbonate, which is nothing but the lime and limestone or lime. It's called calcium carbonate. You know the limestone that is used for for the building material. And we, of course, if the limestone actually compact together, we used to make the chalk for our blackboard, which is used by the school teachers. But of course, nowadays we use the pen. Of course, in the COVID pandemic age, we are not using any chalk and pencil anymore. So they are brittle because they are very randomly oriented calcium carbonate molecules. So you see the structural property is very poor if they are randomly aligned. If you go to the natural material like marble, which is available, if you go to everywhere in the desert or the Rajasthan, very colorful marble, they are very, very hard because there is a very, very strong, good alignment of calcium carbonate molecules. And these are all natural. We didn't do anything. It becomes a very hard marble materials and we use for a lot of applications. The best example is the seashell we get in the sea. This shell is very, very hard and beautiful in color, because not only alignments, they're very orderly alignment of carbon dioxide, calcium carbonate molecule. So these are all God's gift to show us that how can you mimic the nature and get the different properties of the material. So I've taken one more example. Some little bit of video that how, so as I said that we are coming from atoms and molecules, which are actually the dimension is the nanometer scales or few tens of nanometer scales. And we can show that that lot of things are available in the nature, which has shown us that we can use this for making new materials. So of course, this I've taken this from this particular website, Web Coast Nanoscience. So you can visit and see a lot of many other interesting things also there in the nature. Every day we take a sticky feet of the lizards, or as you know that, as you see this, our the world lizards in our home. So did you ever thought that how they actually walk along the walls? In fact, there are some many insects, they can walk along the water also. So they're actually, they've got a very, very special arrangement in their feet. So actually they have got some microstructures or nanostructures in their feet that when they put in their wall, it creates a kind of small kind of vacuum and they can stick onto the wall or they can stick on the water because these are property that it repels water, is a property called hydrophobic, that it repels water. So it can, they can float or they can just, not swimming, they can just walk on the water. So this is an example that natural animal has got this kind of property, and this is depending upon the microstructure of their, of course, feed material. Second example is a strong spider silk. You must have seen a lot of spider silk. And you may think that how strong are they? Actually, they're very, very strong. Their tensile strength is more than the steel. So of course, you can easily break them by a stick because of course they are actually, they're not aligned together, they're not ordered together. But if you take an individual spider silk, the tensile strength of the silk is more than that of steel. That shows that, again, this is made by the fiber and it can be really stretched to a very, very long distance. So you can make new textiles using this example of the spider silk. Then let us take the self-cleaning of or light reflecting butterfly wing colors of the butterflies. So it comes from a actually effect of optical scattering because the size of the surface particles on these butterflies are less than the wavelength of the light. So they scattered light in a different way, and that's why the butterfly looks different colors under different light and even under different angle. Then this is one more kind of some kind of insects. It's called actually beetle. Actually the beetle of, again with different color. Not only do you see that this has got a different color and different pores because nothing but they have got the microstructure of their skin is different at different places. So from different places, they're scattering different wavelengths of light. And that's why you see this beautiful color. Okay, so almost these are enormous examples, of course. These are some kind of called the water beetles that these are available in the desert. So what they do in the, they actually carry some kind of water in these small bumps you can see. So they can carry some of the water, and this water, this stored in this water to drink and survive months after months in the desert. So there is basically nothing but something different in the surfaces and the microstructure. They can collect water, they can store water. So that is the example. And the probably last example I've taken is the, actually that beet of the, that kind of, this particular bird is now called tucan. It's a beautiful beet. So don't think it's a very, very fragile, it's very strong. Because if you see in the exterior, there is a layered kind of this is like that we have. We have called keratin in our hair on the nail. We have got some kind of chemical compound called keratin. So this outer surface is keratin, but inner surface there is got some kind of sponge which looks, which is basically very, very strong in these things. So that's why it does not break easily. So these are all these examples. The list can go on, and you can take. So that's what people are using nowadays in the chemical engineers in the laboratory. They are actually making some kind of material, or they are making some kind of water repellent nanofibers, textiles, or mix of textiles of the clothes, which can actually repel any kind of a water or hydro. It's completely super hydrophobic. So in fact, this is made in the laboratory now. And in fact, the example that people have used, and in fact, in this COVID time, as I said, that a lot of people actually innovated to make a COVID-resistant face mask. As you know, that it's basically COVID spreads to the droplets. So if you can make really some kind of mask whose outer surface is completely kind of hydrophobic, like a lotus leaf or a biscuit of water, so this will never stick to this. So a lot of face masks nowadays using this technology of so-called the self-cleaning or the hydrophobic technology. Okay, so these are some of the examples. So we are always doing this thing. Some more example I have also shown here. This is optical absorption scattering, which I have shown in the beautiful color of the butterfly. And the question is that people nowadays ask, what is the color of the gold? Color of the gold is not bright yellow. In fact, clusters whose size is very, very small, it looks, gold is never, then it's not a metallic. It's some color is something like an orange color. Then if you vary that, increase their size, as a function of the size, their color changes. So this is the beauty of the actually some kind of a nanoparticles, particularly optical nanoparticles, that color changes with the size of the particle. This is called actually size effect. And this has been done by the people for a long time. Even Michael actually made some colloidal solutions about long back without knowing the science. And so basically, they're very, very, as the science I have shown, that basically scattering of the light and the wavelength size of the particle is less than the wavelength of the particle, you get a new kind of phenomena. And of course, for the metallic nanoparticle, there's a phenomena called the resonance of free electrons of the metal particle behave differently. So I don't want to go to the details. This is a little bit complicated. But what is important, as I showed you, if you have seen some of the charges, even if you go to the Goa and Kerala, in Western countries, you get a beautiful colors on the glasses of the charges. So these are made probably 1,000 years back. So there was no nanotechnology at that time. People didn't have a microscope, but they knew how to arrange those metallic nanoparticles on these glass surfaces and get a different kind of colors. You see very, very nice colors on these glass windows. So all the colored glasses that we get nowadays, nothing but on the glasses. Not necessarily gold, it can be any metallic nanoparticle, but the gold is of course one of them, very costly. So this is there in the British Museum. I mean, in future, some of you definitely will be visiting and try to see. This is called a Lycurgus cup. This is available in the British Museum. That it has got different color when it appears green when illuminated from outside, and now it is red when illuminated from inside. So this is not just nothing but the optical scattering occurs. When the light is blown from inside, it looks red. When its guide is illuminated from the outside, it looks green because the light is scattered in a different way to our eyes. So that's a different. But it was done much before this so-called the. Our idea of the nanomaterials or idea of the new materials has come into these things. So people have engineered this particular car probably hundreds of years back. Okay, so now I'll come to the little bit for maybe for the last 10 minutes of the electronic innovation on the electronics. Of course, I know Professor Ramgopal Rao might have done something on that. So let me put last 10 minutes on that innovation on the semiconductor materials. So that we get a lot of innovation in computer chips or so-called the IT technology, etc. Semiconductor is a material, actually you'll read, some of you in the class 11 or 12, you know what is semiconductor. That of course is conductivity is something between metal and insulator. Not only that, it has a negative temperature coefficient of resistance, that is the phase factor. Why it is so interesting? Why we cannot make computers using metals, we need a semiconductor, because this has got very, very interesting properties. This one material, what you can change is conductivity. That means how it conducts the current over 10 orders of magnitude just by changing the materials or changing the doping in the materials. Then if you vary the temperature, if you vary the alloying, if you put an optical radiation, everything you do, you get a defined property. So this temperature variation is used for a device called probably the most sensitive thermometer that is available in the world today. if you make it a, if you just dope it with our different kind of materials, you make junctions and transistors, which are heart of the, or actually our computers and microprocessors. If you can mix two materials, you can get a different kind of semiconductor. If you put some kind of light, actually you generate what is called photoconductivity. So this is nothing but, this is the principle of making the solar cells that I actually discussed. And if you use a magnetic conductor, if you put a magnetic field, you can put a magnetic semiconductor. If you simply put a mechanical pressures, you get some kind of effect. These are called piezo and smart devices. So that's why the semiconductor is so interesting for making devices. And of course, the breakthrough invention in the semiconductor was made about 70 years back by these three people in the Bell Lab when they make first junction transistor. The first transistor that was made by these three people, Shockley, Bartin, and Verdin, for which they got the Nobel Prize, was so crude like this. And first integrated circuit chips, which was made by Texas Instruments, was something like this. But you think of the kind of a microprocessor that you get in your mobile phone, how small it is compared to all these sizes. This has all become possible due to simply reducing the size of the transistor or simply reducing the size of the devices. So why you scale, why you make it from micro scale to macro, so-called the nano scale? Because if you make a smaller in size, the speed of the device, we want a gigahertz speed, we want to hundreds of gigahertz of speed. If we make the smaller sizes, it consumes low power. Of course, we want a portable devices. We want our laptop to be the charge to retain for 2 days, or mobile charge to retain for 2 days. Only you can make when you make a very small size transistor, which consumes very low power. And of course, if we make them high, if we make them smaller, they can have a high density. So that the your so the computer, the functionality or the computation power becomes much better, lower cost. So that's why actually we have come down from so-called the Professor Rao has also shown this curve. This is actually that how we have come down from transistors, or which is the heart of our computer, from about 1970, where we are in the 5 micrometer scale. And today, actually, 2021, we are somewhere here, about 5 nanometer of scale, 7 to 8 nanometer scale. So some of you follow the IBM actually announcement. IBM said they will make a 1 nanometer of transistor size. So think of what will be the power of the transistor. So probably it will come into the market in 2 to 3 years, and your power of mobile phone and the computer will increase enormously, probably the next generation. Okay, there's one more thing, interesting things happen actually. Since we are the physics lecture, I'm sure that some of you in the class 11 and 12, you know that that's so-called the famous principle of de Broglie. De Broglie suggested in physics, so-called in PhD thesis, that any photon, whatever it is, particle, so they either have both kind of properties. They can either behave as a particle or they can actually behave as a wave. That's actually de Broglie hypothesis. That, and it all is depending upon the size of the actually your devices, or the size of the, like your our atoms, atoms are nucleus, the size of the atoms and nucleus are so small, so all the electrons, protons that we have, they actually behave like wave. On the other hand, the electrons in our current transistors actually behave, electron switches when electron moves from here to here, gives a current. So now when you do this nanoscale or really reduce the size of the material, you are actually moving to a technology called the quantum region. So when you are below the de Broglie wavelength of the carrier, or de Broglie wavelength of the carrier, you go to the quantum region. So this is a very interesting story, that as you know, that discovery of electron was done by J.J. Thomson in 1897 or 1906. But his son, G.P. Thomson, his son, only proved by an experiment, and it's called that electron diffracts. So that's why you know that when is electron is a wave, when the electron diffracts from a crystal, that electron is a wave. Or there is the interference diffraction phenomena. And he showed G.P. Thomson in an experiment in 1937. He got Nobel Prize. So the two Nobel Prize, the father and the son, on the same subject. One says it was a particle, one discovers it, and one says, it's not only particle, it is wave, actually, and hypothesis. So there are a lot of interesting things happens when the electron behaves as a wave. So that's what actually I want you is to inspire to do, take up your career in physics in future. So that will be quantum physics. So think of, okay, let us think of the cartoon that electron put in a bucket. Okay, think of it as a bucket. If you put lots of electrons, so electrons will behave as electrons and electrons will go anywhere, move in X, Y, Z directions, and electrons will remain as a particle. How would you put a bucket? So the thickness or the width of the bucket is comparable to de Broglie wavelength. Electrons now behave as a wave, and that is actually quantum mechanics. So it gives some kind of completely different kind of energy in the so-called in the bucket, or the electronic energy in that confined bucket. And you can, using this, you can make lot of lasers, lot of LEDs, lot of other, many other devices. So this is called actually, the device that we made is called quantum well lasers. And today we know that our all fiber optic internet is based on the communications. So in this fiber optic communication, of course, optical fiber is a silicon dioxide fiber. It has got a low absorption only for some particular wavelength of light. Unfortunately, there is no laser material available in the Earth's crust, actually which can propagate through the optical fiber. So the scientists have to make a quantum lasers so that then they get a one particular wavelength which can easily propagate through the fiber optics over hundreds of kilometers without loss. So you know that we have replaced all the copper cables with the cables because it is a low loss communication. Just one more example. That a few years back, about 7 years back, three Japanese scientists actually showed that if you use these, make these kind of a quantum structures or quantum wells, and as I said, that if you change the size of the well, actually you get a defined kind of light. Depending upon the size, you get either blue or green or yellow, and you know if you mix up them, you get actually white light. So all these white light that you get in the market, white LEDs and white these things used for decorations, lightings, are actually based on the principle given by these three people with a very, very complex materials called gallium nitride, indium gallium nitride, just some semiconductor. So what I'm trying to say, everywhere, for every invention, there is invention in the material science. Without invention of the material science, you cannot get a new device, etc. And so everything will change. So probably I'll speed up so that I don't want to. So one more thing, just probably I want to say that our internet, actually, you know, our internet that requirements is increasing every day. So this is like a backdated data I have taken from Cisco website. So per month we are using about 12 exabyte of data in probably in 2017, and now maybe 20 exabyte, 30 exabyte, and 1 exabyte is basically 1 billion gigabytes. So you can think of how much data that we need. Sorry, I just forgot the last this thing. Last slide I showed actually. Here I did a Google search on Satyendranath Bose, and within a few seconds I've got millions of results on Satyendranath Bose, the famous Indian physicist. But what is there hidden in this case? The energy used by a single Google search is equivalent to turning on a 60-watt light bulb for 617 seconds. So let us think of that, how many Google searches per day, and billions of people do how many Google per day, and you multiply that 60 watts, 70 seconds, etc., and try to find out how much of power we are consuming only for the internet, downloading, etc. It will be gigawatts of power. So if you are using gigawatts of power for communication internet, so you have to find that this cannot just grow like this. So just for your example, I mean, I've taken a modern data center from University of California, Santa Barbara. In fact, you can see the picture of the Google data center. It's like a huge, it's almost like a city, mini city. And here, supercomputers are there and connected by all these copper lines. And the main problem in these copper lines, you know that you always know what is the joule heating. If the current passes through a resistor, is basically the amount of heat dissipation is I square R. So there is a resistance in the copper, and there is a basically I square R. So that's a lot of heat is generated, and that's why you have to actually cool these data centers or the Google center with a lot of air conditioned power, which is extremely costly and which is a bad effect on the environment. So the questions, the last question probably I just wanted to see in these particular presentations, and which is also very close to my research interest, whether in the future we can make optical computers. Why optical computers? All the communication, instead of electrons, it will be taken by the photons. So why photons? Because you know the speed of the photon is very, very high compared to the speed of the electrons. So it will be very, very fast. Photon does not have any charge. Electron has a charge. That's why when the electron flows, the current, and if it's a current, it's the I square R, there's Joule heating, but photon does not have a charge. So if the photon flows from one place to another, it does not give any charge. So I can make a device which is, of course, does not draw any current for the propagation switching. And of course, the photon has got a very, very large bandwidth. That's what we use for our internet communications. So combining all these things, in future, we can do kind of a optical, we are optical communications we are already doing today, but we can do really optical computing. So your mobile phones will be super fast with a very, very low amount of power. And that is possible again for the, that will be possible, still not possible in that source. You have to make some different kind of light source, different kind of detectors, different kind of guiding materials. These are basically all innovation in materials. You have to design new materials, you have to invent new materials so that we can get a very fast photonic computer, which is much, much better compared to modern disk computer. So I just showed a kind of this thing that in future, your computer circuits will be not only the electronic transistors, there will be electronic transistors, there will be a lot of optical components, there will be lasers on that. This hybrid system making up electronics and optics together. And that will be the future. I'm sure the next generation people will see. So I end the lecture with that this particular cartoon that, as I said that in the beginning, that there's a lot of invention in the materials. We started with the Stone Age. You had to break, then got a new material called bronze, which is much, much stronger, and we used to do a lot of material science on that. Then somehow we call this dark age. There's not much invention from bronze age to iron age. Of course, that's why it's called dark age. Then the iron age actually has actually made a breakthrough in the, you can say, in the modern civilization for making engineering structures. But of course, we have come to the modern age, which is nothing but the what we call that today we have the computer age or internet age. And I think this innovation and breakthrough, and I'll be happy to see that many of the young students who have attended today, they can really take up your career in physics and chemistry in the future so that you can do a lot of innovation. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Professor Ray, it's a very fascinating lecture and very, very interesting lecture to show wonders of materials. And you touched upon various kind of materials like smart materials, nanostructure materials, self-cleaning properties, artificial nodes, and the nature excitations like color of butterfly, lotus plant, and you have shown that actually the material changes. Although, for example, you took that carbon, it is the carbon that means six atoms, six protons in that. And but if you the way you arranged these atoms, it becomes either charcoal, or it can become diamond, or it can become fullerene ball or a graphene, but it still is a basic atom is carbon only, or carbon nanotube, and each of which has distinctly different properties. So interesting is that. So, and quantum materials, and then towards the actually, the very interesting thing that the Google search is taking 60 watt is one search is equal to 60 watt bulb glowing for 17 seconds, a huge power. That means at one requires the computation and this in by optical way so as to reduce the power. So there's the future. And so many things you talked about and excited the students. So I am very, very thankful for your wonderful lecture. And this, I some glimpse of the questions there. Sure. By the participants, maybe you can pick up some questions from okay, there from and the then answer.
From the chat box, no?
Yeah.
Okay, from the chat box.
And no, from Q&A.
Oh, from Q&A, sorry. Yeah, right. From Q&A, okay. Yes, so I can probably take a few questions.
Yeah.
Okay, so somebody from Ayushman Kaul said that, sir, this graph shows that before 1990, we are dependent more on renewable energy. What kind of that point of time? I think probably you have misread. We are always dependent on our fossil fuel or the coal and this thing, so-called the oils in the Earth's crust. So only after 1900, we are thinking of some renewable energy. So before that, actually, it was all conventional energy. So now non-conventional energy, we are talking of now for the last 50 years or so. Okay, which book, name written by Feynman? Okay, so this is the Feynman's autobiography called, the name of the book is called Feynman. So please find it in your Amazon or somewhere. I'm sure you'll get it. Okay, so what book would you suggest for students like to learn about material science? I suggest don't have to learn material science, you learn pure physics and chemistry. That's what is material science, because material science is nothing but the physics and chemistry. If you learn nicely physics and chemistry up to your 12th class or the graduation level, you will be really material science experts in the future. Okay, so somebody asked interesting questions, how the alignment of calcium carbonate is done. This was some Bikkot Srivastav. Yeah, that's what actually is interesting. So that the nature has done it. How it is done, nobody knows. So that's what the science is about, finding out the nature. You have to find why. So this is available in the Earth's crust, of course, calcium carbonate as a marble or the seashell. And that's what we are studying, and we have to really mimic in the lab.
Yeah.
So that's what the learning
I can add, because in the Earth crust you have very high temperature and pressure. So at very high temperature and pressure, there are a lot of transformation of the how the atoms are arranged in the material. So they change the phase from one to another, and they can get aligned. They can get different kind of crystals. So that's how the nature mother has actually given us, and that gives us lead what to do.
Yeah. That is very nicely pointed out for the Savasti. Okay, maybe one or two more. Brinda Sharma, concept to stationary semiconductor as there is a motion in it. No, De Broglie's concept is actually that, of course, the electrons actually in every whether the metal, semiconductor, electrons always moves actually. When you apply electric field, the electron moves. So the semiconductor may be stationary, but the particle is not stationary. Particle is dynamic and moving. So probably, maybe the last question I will take. Tushar Chaurasia, maybe teacher also. How difficult it is to manage the heating issues of nanoscale device? Any available experimental ways to accurately predict these parameters? It's a very nice scientific question. In fact, that's what the people are working right now. Right now, we are managing the heat just by simply using the heat sinks. So heat sinks, or sometimes people are thinking of, can you use some nano fluids in our computer? See, if you take your laptop there, you see there is something called a fan, exhaust fan, isn't it? So what this fan is doing, fan is taking out the heat from your computer. So can you have a nano channels for the some fluid? Or maybe take some kind of materials like that, as I said, that graphene or diamond, some kind of coatings of materials which has got super, super heat sink property or heat conduct.